So welcome to our Saturday morning session. We will continue on our topic on the glimpses of ancient heritage of India. We briefly covered two, three points. Now we will continue on the next thing, that is the science of yoga. We briefly covered Vedas, astronomy, mathematics and language. Now we will cover science of yoga. Now, the meaning of yoga is to unite. It comes from the Sanskrit root yuj. And basically it means that the unity of the individual with the, you know, global or universal consciousness, that individual soul and the universal soul are united. This is one science which provides us the global view. The whole global family is one single unit. This is what yoga tells us. It also tells us that by having this kind of thinking, the individual differences will disappear and we will think for the greater good of the people. So the basic philosophy behind yoga is not only the spiritual part, but also the practical science, that we should think of the entire universal community as one single unit. This also tells us that we have to remain united and in harmony with the nature, which is one of the biggest problems today we have, what we call climate change or environmental degradation. This has happened because we consider nature as an object of exploitation. There are books written how to exploit nature. We all the time talk about exploitation of minerals, exploitation of water resources, exploitation of, you know, various other natural resources. Now, this basically means that we consider the environment surrounding us as an enemy, and therefore we need to exploit them. Now, this is what the science of yoga tells us, that we have to live in harmony with whatever the rest of the universe is, whether it is moving or non-moving. We are united, we are one single unit, and without realization of this fact, we cannot live in harmony. So there are two aspects here. One aspect is the aspect that all other species of life, including humans, we are all interconnected and we have to live in harmony. Secondly, that all the natural forces which are operating in the universe, we have to live with them in harmony. Otherwise, there would be conflict. And of course, the third aspect of yoga is spiritual, that you unite your individual soul with the what we call Paramatma or the universal soul. We will deal with these issues in greater detail later on. But right now I am confining myself to very short presentation on these major issues. Now, this science of yoga originated in India. In fact, of course, Patanjali is considered one of the founders of yoga. But you can see that there are many scientists, I mean Indian rishis, who propounded the science of yoga much before Patanjali. We have references of science of yoga in various Puranas. We also have reference in Ramayana, in Mahabharata, which are much older than the time of Patanjali. So this science had existed in India for times immemorial. There's no point in going into the timelines, because the timelines, as I mentioned earlier, are highly inaccurate and blurred. Then we go to the science of life, that is Ayurveda. If you look in the world, if you investigate various life sciences, Ayurveda is the most ancient science of life anywhere in the world. In fact, there are claims that this is as old as 10,000 BC. But I again don't want to go into those claims. But this science is the foundation even of allopathic, which is operating today in a big way. In allopathic science today, they have taken the Ayurvedic science as the base and refined the medicines further. For example, they take the aloe vera plant, they take extract out of that plant and they keep refining it further to make it more and more effective. When you make it more and more effective, obviously it works faster, but also it has side effects because anything which works faster in the body will naturally have side effects. Like food we eat, it doesn't give any reaction in the body. It becomes body parts without any side effects. But if we take chemicals, obviously the chemicals react very fast in the body and they leave a variety of side effects. So Ayurveda is entirely based on what we call plants and herbs, all the natural substances which are available. That is the foundation of Ayurveda. Ayurveda basically means science of life, Ayu and Ved. Ayurvigyan, we can call it, that is the science of life. Now, in this science, there were a variety of things which we will deal with separately, slowly, slowly, when we move forward. But right now, I just wanted to mention that this is the oldest science anywhere in the world in the sphere of human health. And this science was very well developed in the past. I have seen, you know, even in my childhood, there were Vaidyas who could, you know, put their hand on the nadij on your right hand and will tell you the entire history of your illness, not only of your illness, your entire health. And I have that experience personally myself. So that science was very well developed at some stage. We had these shops of Pansari everywhere in villages, where you can get these herbs and make your medicine at home. Now, unfortunately, all that has become a thing of past. In the last 50 years, most of it has disappeared. We have Ayurvedic doctors, but those doctors are not as, you know, I would say, well-trained as they should be, as our ancient rishis were. So this is one of the sciences which we contributed to the world and which is the, in my view, only science which can actually save humanity from the scourge of repeated illnesses. Because all other medical techniques and sciences we have today, they have their side effects. The side effects can reflect immediately, can reflect after 5 years, can reflect after 10 years, but they continue to haunt humanity. And that is the reason Ayurveda is the hope of the future. Now, in terms of modern medical research, in US, recently, not in about last 10 years, many researches have been undertaken to analyze the causes of illness. They have come out with a conclusion that approximately two-thirds of total illnesses we suffer as a humanity, they are as a result of the side effects of the medications you had taken in the past. Now we can imagine the side effects of allopathic medicine, which is causing approximately two-thirds of total illnesses. It is because the allopathic medicines are highly refined and they are practically chemicals, and those chemicals cannot assimilate with our body, and therefore they leave lot of side effects and traces in the body, and that is why more and more illnesses keep surfacing. You would have seen yourself that lot of allopathic medicines which were routinely prescribed in the past are considered poisonous today, after 5 years, after 10 years, after 15 years. So imagine what happened to those people who took those medicines based on the doctor's prescription. So this is what has happened to allopathic science. I'm not saying that allopathy is all bad. No, allopathy has its own good points. The one important good point is that it is very good in emergency. When you need to save life, it helps you. It has developed very good technique of surgery. So that is also very helpful today. So these two very important points, allopathy can be assimilated with Ayurveda, and we can try and go back to Ayurveda to avoid side effects of variety of medicines. So this is another contribution of India, which was a contribution to the entire world, the Ayurveda. Now, let us look at the gastronomy of the world. Many of you have traveled around the world. I have traveled in many countries myself. I have not found any gastronomical delights which are superior than Indian gastronomy. Most of the gastronomical delights we have, firstly, they are vegetarian. Secondly, they are based on variety of spices. Thirdly, they are actually used to be made at home by mixing variety of things which are good for our health. So those gastronomical inventions which our ancestors did, they were highly sophisticated. Indian cuisine, which is known in the world today, is not really Indian cuisine. It's basically Punjabi cuisine, which you can see abroad. In India, if you go around, you will find every state has a different cuisine. Not only state, within the state, every part of the state has a different cuisine. Like Rajasthani cuisine, it's so many varieties. You go to Maharashtrian cuisine, there are so many varieties. No country in the world can offer you that kind of variety in its cuisine. Nowhere in the world. And this cuisine is based on a profound science, whereby the qualities of every grain, every pulse, every spice, every herb, every plant, and every fruit has been properly analyzed and mixed in our gastronomy. For example, during this monsoon season, we take lemon. Lemon is very good, and some people heat the lemon by adding what they call pepper, that is kali mirch, kala namak, and sometimes salt, and they take it in the empty stomach. This is a fantastic medicine to what you call detoxify your body. This has been designed based on Indian herbs and the fruits. So you take lemon. This is not a medicine, but it's basically a homemade remedy which you can take every morning before you eat anything, and it will detoxify your stomach, your entire system. There are thousands and thousands of them. It goes to the extent that you will use, for example, rye in a particular vegetable, and you will use sarso in another vegetable, and you will use jeera in a third vegetable. So it has gone to a very fine and very scientific way in a very, very minute detail. If you check the cuisine of our grandfather, grandmother's time, they will tell you the science behind the gastronomy. In every Indian home, we can find that science. But unfortunately, we are now more attuned to what we call fast food and Western fast food. So that is obviously taking a toll on our health. I think it's time that we understand the science behind our own gastronomy and promote our gastronomy not only in our own country, but abroad as well. Now, let us go briefly on metallurgy. Now, a lot of people believe, in fact, I have been interviewing a lot of aspirants for civil services, and a large number of them come from engineering background. And a large number of them do not know what was the metallurgical science in ancient India. If we go to Delhi, in the Kutub complex, you find a pillar, which is called iron pillar, which was in the center of a temple once upon a time. That pillar is at least 1700 to 1800 years old. It's right in the open, exposed to all climatic conditions. It has not rusted. The modern science is not able to produce anything similar, which will not rust for so many, almost 2000 years, and still remains in the open. So look at the science behind that metallurgy. Obviously, people made weapons at that time. Weapons were in use. We have seen in the war of Mahabharata. We have seen in Ramayana, the weapons were in use. So all those weapons had metal, some content of metal here or there. So metallurgy was one of the sciences which was very well developed in India way back at least 5,000 years in time. I was told that in many temples in South India, there are iron pillars like in Delhi, and which also stand in open, and they have not rusted till today. This tremendous reference to gold and silver in our scriptures. Obviously, the metallic science was very well developed. That is why they could make use of gold and silver in terms of ornaments in ancient time. So we have to look at the various sciences, engineering sciences that existed in our time, in those times. If we look at the what you call ruins of the Indus Valley civilization, they give you an idea of very well-developed civil engineering, very well-developed town planning, and very well-developed architecture of that time. Not only that, I went to Khajuraho several years ago, and I was amazed that those temples, which are approximately 1100 years old, they have a drainage system which has lasted so long. Normally, the water seepage you will experience in all major buildings today. Even the most, what we call, great architectural feat of today have water seepage problems, and which ultimately damages the building sooner or later. But if you go and see the ancient temples, whether you go to, Madurai, or if you go to Khajuraho, or if you go to any other place, the ancient temples actually show us how to have a drainage system which will not impact on the building itself at all. It was amazing when I went to Cambodia and I saw those, beautiful temples, Hindu temples there. They they cannot even be restructured. All the stones are lying there in thousands, but we cannot even put them back in the form of the temple. It was such a phenomenal science which our ancestors had developed, and which you can find in the temples in Bali, you can find in Cambodia, you can find in Vietnam, of course you can find in Myanmar, in of course ancient Indian temples. So even in some places in Afghanistan, which were destroyed by Taliban's last time. So all these engineering feats were developed by our ancestors in those times. So we should not underestimate what they contributed in terms of metallurgy, in terms of other engineering sciences in ancient India. Now let us have a look at architecture. I have briefly covered in this thing, because when you design a temple, temple architecture has been the most significant in India in the past, because the people normally lived in very, what you call simple way. They used to have clay houses and they used to live in a very simple manner. And they lived in a very natural way without inviting nature's fury. But at the same time, the architecture in temples were the most sophisticated. In some temples in India, every single piece of stone is an architecture in itself, because they have used intricate designs to carve out those pieces of stones, and they have put them together in the temple. So this is a fantastic thing. Even today, the temple architecture of India is one of the most important architecture around the world. People come to India to study temple architecture, and then they adopt those architectural techniques abroad. So this is another science of ancient India, which has been given to the world. Of course, you know the references in Mahabharata, when the empire was divided between Kauravas and Pandavas, and Indraprastha was created as the new capital for Pandavas. And the kind of city which was developed that time, and the palace in which Duryodhan could not distinguish between water and normal surface, he could not distinguish between a mirror and the normal walls. And you have seen those scenes, they are vividly described in Mahabharata. So obviously there must have been some architectural expertise in our ancient people who developed those kind of architecture and who developed those cities, which are also available in Indus Valley civilization. And those cities present a good example that how well developed our architecture in the past was. So this is one one more contribution of India, ancient India, to the world in terms of architecture. Now, Dhanurvidya, archery. Archery has been one of the most ancient method in warfare, because this is one technique through which you can attack your enemy at least 1 kilometer or half a kilometer away. This kind of technique you will find in many ancient civilizations. When I was posted in Mongolia, I found there were people who were expert in archery and could send their arrow almost 500 to 600 meters. Now I'm talking about present time. In ancient times, of course, there were different descriptions, but obviously the archery was one of the most developed, science of warfare. And we know Arjuna was one of the greatest archer of that time. not only during the time of Mahabharata, even before, in the time of Ramayana. You have seen archery, because Rama was one of the greatest archer in the world, and that has also been referred to in Bhagavad Gita, when Krishna talks about Rama as one of the greatest, you know, Dhanurdhari in the world. So archery was another science which was developed in India, and this was linked with horse riding. Horse riding and archery were, you know, they're interlinked with each other, and they worked together. Now let us look at religions or dharmashastra. We call it not religions but dharmashastra, or we can call it simply dharma. The modern world religion is a very misnomer. Actually, the religion to me looks like a political party, because you have Christianity, you have Islam, you have Judaism. They are religion in this sense of the Latin word religion. And they claim that they are superior to the rest of the religions. Each one of them put that claim, and they convert people to their religions. So it's like taking somebody in your political party, that my party is superior and I will do better job by adopting this kind of technique, so join me. So this is what exactly the nature of religion is in the modern world. But in India, we have never used the word religion. It was actually called dharma or dharmashastra. Now, dharma is a very, you know, profound word, which is not easy to define. We have discussed this word in the past. Actually, dharma is a science which enables you to distinguish what is right, what is wrong, what is ethical, what is not ethical, what is moral, what is immoral, what is legal, what is not legal, what is socially acceptable, what is not socially acceptable. All those parameters are tested with this word called dharma. Now, I found Mahabharata as the greatest expose on dharma. Various situations have been explained there to define various aspects of dharma. In which situation, what should be done? One of the most talked about situation is when Draupadi's, sari was to be, she was to be denuded under the instructions of Duryodhan. And that time, what was the dharma of Bhishma and what was the dharma of Dronacharya, what they did, what they did not do, that is one of the big, questions of dharma in India. Similarly, there is a question of dharma in Ramayana in many places. When Rama attacked Bali, hiding himself behind a tree, there is also a question on dharma. There are lot of questions in regular, questions on dharma, and there are more intricate questions in dharma. What is right, what is wrong for a person to do in a particular situation depends on two major factors. One is the time, and second is the circumstances. This we call it des and kal. Kal is time, and des is basically, you can call it, circumstances and the place put together in one particular unit. So des and kal, or circumstances and time, they are the parameters on which the dharma is to be decided. What is right, what is wrong? Because the definition of right and wrong changes with time and place. What we consider right in India may be considered wrong, for example, in US or in Europe. Or what is considered right in Saudi Arabia may be considered wrong here. Like what Talibans are considering right is totally wrong in rest of the world. So this is one issue which is very, very foundational to human existence. How do we define dharma? How do we define, the behavior of the people? Because dharma is the parameter on which the behavior of the individuals has to be defined. So that definition will actually determine individual behavior, social behavior, our conduct in the society, and our relationship with the rest of the society. So this is one very profound, shastra which India developed and gave to the world. It is completely non-sectarian. It has nothing to do with the, what you call rituals of religion. Because religion in the modern sense is associated with rituals. You follow the Christian rituals, you follow the Jewish rituals, you follow the Hindu rituals, then your religion is decided. But dharma is not actually associated with any rituals. It is associated only with right and wrong. What should be done under given circumstances in a particular given time. And that is what dharma is actually a profound science, which explains to us what we should do, how do we conduct in the society, how do we behave with the rest of the society, how do we, deal with various relationships between husband and wife, between father and, son, between mother and the son, between brother and brother, between employee and employer, between, say, grandfather and grandson. So all types of relationships which exist in the world, and they are based on dharma. And the dharma shastra tells us how we conduct ourselves in different situations. There are variety of tests, variety of touchstones on which you have to put dharma and test what is right and what is wrong. So this is another contribution of ancient India to the world, dharma shastra. Then we go to political science. When I ask this question to these aspirants for civil services, who are the greatest political scientists in the world? They start with Aristotle and Plato and Socrates. Nobody actually knows about Chanakya or Kautilya, or very few people know about him. If you look at Chanakya, it's approximately 4th century BC. It is around the time of Alexander's invasion of India, when Chanakya was there. Now, he was one of the greatest political scientists world has ever had. He is not a theoretician. He did not do a mental exercise in political science as Aristotle did. Aristotle's exercise was primarily a thinking exercise, a thought process, which was written down. While Chanakya's process was a practical process. He applied that science in practice in variety of situations. When the country was fighting against Alexander, and when he put together the empire of Chandragupta Maurya, and how he put together all different, small empires and rulers under Chandragupta Maurya. So he practiced that political science and then wrote his book called Arthashastra. Though it is titled Arthashastra, but it is more on politics and less on economics. It's also on economics. It also gives the fundamental, norms of behavior of a king, how the king should rule the nation, what should be his duties, what kind of taxes he should impose, what kind of, secret service he should have, what kind of policing he should do, All those things are mentioned in detail in Arthashastra. But in Arthashastra, he defines foreign policy in a big way. He talks how you should deal with your neighbors, how you should deal with the enemies of your neighbors and friends of your neighbors. There's a very big, what you call theory of mandala, which has been prescribed in Arthashastra by Chanakya. So Chanakya was a political science at home, but he was also a political science, which we call diplomacy today, that is the international relations. And he was also an economist who advised the kings how to use their taxation policy, what kind of rationality should be there in taxation, what kind of principles should be adopted so that the taxation are fair, the taxes are not a burden on the society. At the same time, the king is able to run its apparatus, the apparatus of the state, and is able to have enough funds to fight a war if needed. So all these things have been explained in Chanakya's Arthashastra. He has also written a Niti Shastra, Chanakya Niti, which is called. So these are contributions of India, which are very, very ancient to the political science, to diplomacy, and to economics. Now today we will take this brief description on the last topic, Sangeet evam Natya, that is music and dancing. If you go around the world, you will find there are no dances and music more ancient than the classical Indian dances and ragas in music in India. These are the most ancient, refined form of dances. You will find, of course, what you call folk dances in various parts of the world, depending upon their agricultural activities, depending upon their day-to-day life activities. Folk music and folk dances has been there everywhere in the world. But the refined dances and music, which we find in India in the forms of Shastriya Sangeet and Shastriya Natya, you will not find anywhere in the world. And this dance form and this music form is actually dedicated to the Almighty. All the classical dances were dances in the temples dedicated to the Almighty. Each one of their words is like a praise to the Almighty. It's part of the bhakti, it's part of the devotion to the Almighty, both music and dance. So this is, I would say, the most refined form of dance and music you can find is in India. The oldest writings on dance, the oldest pictures of dances and musical forms are from India, from nowhere else. You go to Indus Valley civilization, you will find a variety of statues on the walls where the people are dancing in classical way. They depict classical dances. They depict musical instruments, and both folk and classical. So this is another contribution of India to the world, our heritage, that we have contributed classical, that is refined dance form and refined music, to the world, which is actually dedicated to the Almighty. This is one music and dance which cools your mind, which makes you divine, which makes you feel, peaceful. Other dances anywhere in the world will not make you feel peaceful, will not quieten your mind. In fact, they excite your mind. But Indian forms of classical dances and music, they are designed to bring your mind to what we call a quiet place, to make it peaceful, to make it still, so that its movements are, contained to the minimum. So this is what I would suggest, in brief, some of the important contributions of India to the world, and this is part of our heritage, Indian heritage, which has been contributed by our ancestors to us, but unfortunately we have not been able to keep it intact. A large part of it has disappeared. Some part which is existing is in a very, you know, what you call depreciated state, which is not pure state, which is very impure, very diluted state. So it is important that we do some research on these issues and bring these parts of our ancient heritage to the world, to our own progeny, to our own people. Now, in the next talk, we will go into a little more detail, like I will take the first will education system in ancient India. That would be our next topic next Saturday. So here I would like to stop with this, what we call a broad outline of variety of ancient Indian heritage, which was developed by our ancestors and given to the world and to our own country. It is time that we look at it and we go into some more details of these heritage, so that our progeny, our youngsters, our new generations know about the great heritage of India. So thank you very much. And if you have any questions, we will go into details on where some of these issues, like education is one of them. Then we will go on, some of the Vedic writings in some detail. Then we will go on mathematics and some of those other issues in our next presentations, one by one. So what I would suggest today, if you have questions on the general outline of these topics, I would be very happy to answer. And let us leave the details for the next talks. We will go into them in greater detail in our weekly talks. So thank you so much.